2019 UPSC paper discussion session. I am Mudit Jain. Presently, I am working in Indian Revenue Service, before in Indian Police Service for a couple of batches. So to set it straight, I have scored more than 110 thrice in ethics, and I have also written two books in ethics. My latest one is Decode Ethics, which has the solved papers of all the 5 years. 19 officers have contributed in that book. So let's start with today's topic, that is 2019 paper. So the first question of section A in this year's paper was, what are the basic principles of public life? Illustrate any three of these with suitable examples. So if you have watched previous of my videos on ethics, I have clearly mentioned that ethics is all about wordplay. You have to write as many keywords as possible, and you have to literally sell yourself to gain marks from the examiner. Plus, you have to be innovative and unique. So to start with, what I told in one of my video was that what I used to do in the first question is that I used to implicitly tell the examiner that I have been already selected into the services. Now you cannot straightforward write that you are in service. What you can do is mention that mention the examples like while you were in training for so and so service, or while giving UPSC interview last year such and such incident happened, or while you were going through the medical test of UPSC such and such thing happened. Why this is? Because if there is to be some positive bias from side of examiner, then let's gain it from the first question itself till the last question. So let's begin with this question. First, you have to define what is public life. Without definition, do not move forward. Then we all know about Nolan's committee, but not all know that Nolan's committee was on public life. So if you know Nolan's committee on public life, then you can mention the 7 principles given by Nolan, that are selflessness, openness, objectivity, honesty, accountability, integrity, and leadership. So this will make for the first part of the question. Now the second part is, illustrate any three of these with suitable examples. Now pick any three keywords for which you can write a good example, because the question clearly mentions that you have to illustrate with suitable examples. So I'll pick selflessness, honesty, and leadership. And as I said, that you have to quote in the first question that you are through the process once, or you are in the services. For selflessness, you can write that while you were in hospital for medical test, such and such incident happened. So that will tell examiner that you have been through the process, you are experienced guy, you are not just out of the college. I'm not saying that it makes a difference that you are out from the college or you are from the first attempt, but then let's gain the positive bias. Second is honesty. Honesty, keep it simple, like honesty in daily work, honesty with yourself. Then leadership. Leadership is very important in public services. So do not forget to quote leadership in this question. Like, for example, you can say that while training, you were coordinating such and such event, or in your professional life, you were coordinating such and such event, and then you led from the front. That shows leadership quality. After the examples, in ethics, I always draw diagrams. Diagram for me is +1 mark per question. So if you are drawing at least 10 diagrams in ethics paper, then for me, what I consider is that you will get 10 marks plus than the other competitor. So draw a diagram. In this question, you can easily draw a hub and spoke diagram. Like in the center, write public life principles, and then draw 7 spokes, and write 7 principles from the Nolan committee. Last is conclusion. Conclusion is must in examples in paper, because without conclusion, you might lose 1 or 2 marks. You won't gain extra marks, but then you will definitely lose a couple of marks in paper. So conclusion is must. Coming on to the next question, what do you understand by the term public servant? Reflect on the expected role of public servant. Now, it is a very generic question. Nobody expected UPSC to ask the definition of public servant. So, frankly speaking, do not write a general definition, even though you don't know the exact definition of what is public servant. So, best in this type of question is to quote ARC, because definitely ARC would have defined public servant some or other way. So, write whatever you want and just write as given in ARC. Public servant means this, this and that. Coming to the second part, reflect on the expected role, or you can also include from the Weber question that UPSC gave once, that good attributes of a public servant. You can include from its definition as well. Coming on to the roles of public servant, it is again a very generic question. So what will be the role of public servant is like family, then individual, then society, professional, jobs, etc. So the key is to arrange the ideas in a structured format. It helps if you read a particular theory on this topic, because like in my book, public servant roles are given in the following diagram. It clearly mentions various hierarchies of a public servant. What is the expected? Also, you can include from given in the Code of Ethics 1997, and examples you have to write, you can write from Ajit Doval sir or Sridharan sir. Diagram again in this question is hub and spoke diagram, or the diagram that I showed you from the book. And lastly, you have to write conclusion. Conclusion is must in every question. Just summarize what you have written, definition and the rules. Next is effective utilization of public funds is crucial to meet development. So this question, first you have to define what are public funds. Like three types of public funds given in the Constitution of India, you can write on that. You can write about doctrine of trust and doctrine of appropriateness. These are two doctrines which are linked with utilization of public funds. Now breaking down the question, it has many parts. That is why it is a very tough question to handle. It's critical view. So in critical analysis, you have to write both sides, pros and cons. So 2 points you will write for underutilization, pro and con, 2 points for misutilization, pro, and 2 points for misutilization, cons. So in all till now you have written 2 points for why it is crucial to meet development goals, then 4 points on underutilization, 4 points on misutilization. These are 10 points. Lastly comes the implications of utilization. So you will write at least 2 or 3 points. In all, hence, this question is very tricky because it has more points. You cannot think much, you have to write, because you have to complete this question in 7 minutes. Lastly, you can summarize what you have written in form of a diagram. Like I used to draw flowchart in ethics paper, especially in case studies. So the first block of flowchart can be if utilization is done or not. Then a node will come yes and no. If it is done, then say it leads to good governance. If it leads to good governance, then it meets development goals. And if utilization is not done, write no, then it does not lead to good governance and it does not meet development goals. And lastly comes conclusion. Next question is, non-performance of duty by public servant is a form of corruption. Do you agree with this view? Justify your answer. Now, it is again a very tricky question. You can ask me this question in GS2, polity. But then this question has been asked in ethics. So answer must be written in terms of ethics. It is very easy to write a generic answer in this question, but I demand ethics keywords in this question because it is a question of ethics. So first you can define what is duty. You can easily invoke Kant or Gandhi's views on duty. You can also define corruption in introduction, the forms of corruption like coercive bribery, collusive bribery, or other forms of corruption that you might know. Then set it straight that do you agree with this view or not. Also, you can, in non-performance of duty by public servant is a form of corruption. So I would have written in affirmation, in agreement of this question. Now you have to prove your view with examples. So for example, You can write a doctor in public hospital not doing his duty in his public capacity, public servant capacity, and managing his own private clinic might risk a life of many people, many patients. So this is a form of corruption. Second, you can write a public servant not taking a decision, that is omission, action in omission. It might be because he has colluded with some other party. So it is a form of corruption. Then draw a diagram and conclude. Next is, what is meant by term constitutional morality? How does one uphold constitutional morality? Here comes the use of GS, studying GS. This term was in news quite a lot times in 2018 and 19. Three with examples. So you have written what is constitutional morality, you have mentioned the news background. And then you have mentioned various principles like sovereignty, socialism, or unity and integrity of India from preamble, from DPSP or elsewhere. This will show the examiner that you know what you are writing about. And this gives theoretical inputs also in your answer. Like in other videos, I have already told that 10% of your answer must be theory and rest 80 to 90% of your ethics answer must be example based. So in this question, I would have written example of patriotism in daily life by doing my fundamental duties. So if I do so, I'll upheld constitutional morality. Then by paying taxes, we can upheld constitutional values and constitutional morality by ensuring economic justice, social justice and equality. So this is the way you can easily prove the given statement. Then in this question, you can draw a Venn diagram, like draw two circles. First circle is patriotism, second circle say paying taxes, and the middle one, color it and say constitutional morality. So if you are doing all both things, if you are upholding these two principles, you will be upholding constitutional morality. This also adds variety to your diagram. You are not only drawing hub and spoke and flowchart in every question, you have Venn diagrams also. Last, conclude by writing that hence, if we are following these and these principles, then we can easily uphold constitutional morality. So far, the question discussed, you can find them in my book. Like the first question, public life, it is on page number 76. The roles of public servant are on page number 781. Then the misutilization of public funds and implications. I have given sample questions in my book. You can see for yourself that same sample question is mentioned in the book on page 334. I have not solved it in book because I didn't expect UPSC to give such question, but then the same question is present in my book. Next is, what is meant by crisis of conscience? How does it manifest itself in public domain? Now, conscience has been asked multiple times by UPSC, so you must have expected this question again. In this question, first define conscience. Do not directly jump to crisis of conscience. Write a name of thinker associated with conscience, like you can write about Gandhi, or you can write about Saint Paul, or you can write about Aquinas, etc. Then write what is crisis of conscience. Crisis of conscience can be equated with knower-doer split as explained by Swami Dayanand Saraswati. In this, there is a knower, like I know that smoking is injurious to health, but then I am not quitting it. So that is a doer. So there is a split between knower and doer. There is a crisis of conscience involved. So you can quote thinker in this question. How does it manifest itself in the public domain? Now you have to write about various examples from the public domain where you see crisis of conscience. For example, in the previous question, like we mentioned, not doing duty is a form of corruption. So that is a crisis of conscience, that public servant is not doing his or her duty. Not upholding integrity to fullest is a crisis of conscience. Involving in corruption is crisis of conscience. Not maintaining administrative secrecy in matter of national importance, national security is a crisis of conscience. Poor ethical frameworks in organization or supporting nepotism, each of these are examples of crisis of conscience. So there are n number of examples. For this question, diagram becomes very easy. you can draw a hub and spoke diagram, or you can draw a flow chart depicting what is crisis of conscience, what it leads to, how to solve it. Last comes conclusion. Next is, explain the basic principles of citizen charter movement and bring out its importance. It is a very straightforward and very easy question. First, define what is citizen charter. Then write what was basic origin of the citizen charter movement, where it started. It started in UK, then other countries followed. India has followed the footsteps. What are the various principles of citizen charter movement? There were 6 basic principles that came in the first movement, like quality, service, etc. Then these expanded to 9 principles later on. So you can write a number of principles in this. Also explain at least 2 principles with examples, because this question has only 2 parts: what are basic principles and importance. So just not write principles, explain at least 2 with examples. Then importance, bring out its importance. It is a very general question. It is mentioned in GS2 syllabus as well, but then again, as I said previously, this is paper of ethics, so I want ethics keywords in the answers. So the best way to do it is learning the syllabus. So if you know the terms of syllabus, like quality of service delivery, good governance, code of conduct, etc., then you can easily link with citizen charter positives. Like, if I implement citizen charter, then I will ensure quality of service delivery. If I am implementing citizen charter, then I am ensuring good governance. If I am implementing citizen charter, then I might be in direction to implement the code of conduct and code of ethics for public servants. Again, draw a diagram after this and conclude by summarizing the points that you have written. Next, there is a view that the Official Secrets Act is an obstacle to the implementation of RTI. Do you agree with the view? This is perhaps one of the few tricky questions of this year paper, because again it is linked with GS2, not so much with GS4 but with GS2. What you can do is, first in introduction, define what is Official Secret Act, or define what is RTI. Quote ARC, because ARC has clearly mentioned about Official Secret Act and National Security Act, etc. Then what is your view? Do you agree or do you not agree? In this question, I would have taken both sides, not a single view, because it might be tricky. It depends on what view the examiner has taken. So it is better to write both views. First view, like, yes, it impacts the implementation of RTI. Write one example of that, like normal trade secrets or the normal information that is not of importance for national security is also sometimes barred under Official Secrets Act in the veil of national security. So it creates hurdles in implementation of RTI. Second, you can take a view that no, it is very important for national security purpose. It is important for India's economic security and all, because mischief has been noted in form of RTI of late. So Official Secret Act is important to avoid such mischiefs. Draw a flowchart diagram taking both the views. Official Secret Act hinders RTI, yes or no? In yes, just present what you have already written in the question in both yes and no views. Then conclude by giving a way forward approach in this question, like what needs to be done so to ensure that Official Secret Act is refined and it does not create unnecessary hurdle in implementation of RTI. Giving a way forward approach is very important in this particular question. Next is, what do you understand by probity in governance? Based on your understanding of the term, suggest measures for ensuring probity in governance. Very simple question against very bookish, straightforward theoretical question. First, you have to define probity. Then you have to suggest measures to ensure probity. There is not much to write in this question. So if this is a 10 marker, I would expect 5 points each for each part, like 5 points under what is probity, 5 points under how to ensure probity. So for probity, 5 points you have to include somehow from the syllabus itself. What the syllabus of the probity topic, in it includes topics like corruption or service delivery or strengthening of probity in governance and administration. So various topic itself, by using them, you can make up the definition and principles related to probity. Then how would you ensure probity in governance? Very simple again, like you have in syllabus code of conduct, code of ethics, foundational values, emotional intelligence, laws, rules, regulations, conscience, etc. So using all these terms of the syllabus itself, you can easily write that you will ensure implementation of code of conduct to ensure probity. You will ensure formulation and implementation of code of ethics to ensure probity. You will ensure that you will practice emotional intelligence, and you will also help your employees follow emotional intelligence to ensure probity. You will work on the ethical framework of your organization to ensure probity. It is a very easy question. In example, you can write a random example, like a particular officer changed the work culture of his or her organization in this and that state by invoking easy low-hanging fruits of code of conduct, code of ethics, etc. It can be a random example. Then draw a diagram and conclude. Next is, emotional intelligence is the ability to make your emotions work for you instead of against you. Do you agree with this view? Discuss. It is a very good question. I guess only good question of this year paper, else other questions are too direct and too straight, too theoretical. So first is, define what is emotion, or define what is emotional intelligence, and write thinker's name of Goleman or other thinker related to emotional intelligence that you might know. So definition that I would have written is that emotional intelligence means to have control and manage your emotions and emotions of others, and to be able to put yourself in others' shoes to manage their emotions. So now the question talks about, it is the ability to make your emotions work for you, not against you. Divide the question in two parts. First, how emotions work for you. Under this, write example of MS Dhoni, how he uses his emotions for betterment of the team and betterment of sport. And against you, you can write the example of Sarfaraz Ahmed, that is Pakistan captain, how he shows his emotions every now and then on field, and that affects his bowlers and all. So you have to use your emotions for you, not against you. Now, in my book, there are n number of quotes related to emotional intelligence topic. You can pick and choose the quotes from there, because I think at least 4 or 5 quotes directly fit into this particular question. Draw a Venn diagram where in first circle say emotional, in second circle say intelligent, and in the middle Venn say emotionally intelligent. It is a very easy diagram. It hardly takes 10 seconds to draw this diagram, and the impact of it would be +1 in your score. Lastly, conclude your question. Then our quote-based question, and this year they asked what it means to you in the present context instead of what it means to you as public servant. Still, in quote-based question, as I have suggested before, that you need to write 2 examples. So first example should be from a general life, general, you can write from GS, etc. And second example must be relevant for public servant, because you are writing an exam to enter public services. So it is important you try to implement these codes in public life. Now, another important thing in code-based question is that do not limit yourself to the thinker. Like in this code, thinker is Socrates, or in other code, thinker is Gandhi or Dr. Kalam. You should not restrict yourself to the thinker, you need to focus on the quote, focus on the examples, focus on its relevance in the current scenario for public life, and you can write one or two points on thinker, not more than that. Make it application based. So yesterday I googled this quote, an unexamined life is not worth living. What actually Socrates meant by saying this? The results are that he claims that only in striving to come to know ourselves and to understand ourselves do our lives have meaning or value. Consigns inner self, soul, virtues, inner peace and contentment, like mentioned in Sikhism also, are the keywords associated with what Socrates wanted. So in nutshell, it means that you have to look inner. You have to know yourself first. You have to examine yourself, your weaknesses, your shortcomings. You have to do what is good for your soul and then look outwards. Because till you live an unexamined life, it is not worth living. Now, example of this, you can quote from IER, say like Pakistan, related to an individual. Pakistan as an individual is a country that is a rogue state. It is a failed state. It is living an unexamined life because it is not looking inside itself. It is not living a peaceful life inside or outside. So it is a country that is living a life that is not worth living. Another example you can write for a public servant who is not true to his duty, who is not honest, who is not upholding integrity, who is not serving the nation, who is not serving the weaker sections of the society. He is living an unexamined life that is not worth living. It is unbecoming of a public servant. Next, draw a diagram and conclude. So the second last question from section A is, a man is but a product of his thoughts, what he thinks he becomes, quote by Mahatma Gandhi. Now if you try to link it with syllabus, then this can be breakdown into attitude, because attitude chapter has attitude has three contents, that is thought, belief and behavior. So thought, emotions and behavior. So thoughts and behavior part of attitude content can be related to this quote. So this would form the theoretical inputs that you want to write in your answer. So first link behavior with thoughts. Then you can also write about cognitive dissonance theory. How it is, I'll come to it next. Like this quote again can have two parts. Thoughts deciding the behavior of person, and thoughts not deciding the behavior of person. In the first part, it is clear that what a person thinks he becomes. This is an affirmation of the quote. So if you think that smoking opposite of what I said in the first part, and say that it is not always necessary that you become what you think, because there are a number of guys who know that smoking is injurious to health, but they are still not able to quit it. Relevance in public service, like you know examples of good bureaucrats like Sridharan sir or Ajit Doval sir. You want to become like them. You can invoke cognitive dissonance, as I told before, because cognitive dissonance says that a person has thoughts in some direction, but then his behavior differs from that. So you can write that passing reference of that theory. You have to handle it in multiple dimensions. Last question of first section is a quote given by Dr. Kalam. It is a long quote, so I'll break it down. It starts from individual's heart, then it talks about individual's character, then it talks about harmony in his home, then in his nation, and then the world peace. So these are five basic points. How to deal with this quote? Start with a child. That there is a child who has righteousness in his heart, then growing up he'll become a man with good character. He'll uphold virtues like prudence, justice, temperance, etc. Then his home, his entire home would be peaceful. There would be beauty and harmony in his home. And then come to nation, that station is sum total of the individuals. So if 1, 2, 3, 4 n number of individuals are having harmony at home, then nation will have harmony as such. And then you can write about world is sum total of nations. If nations have harmony, then world as such will have peace and security. Now what you can write from ethics per se, because till now the answer is very generic. From ethics you can write Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam, that world is a family. So if nations, individual nations are harmony, are depicting harmony, then world will have harmony. You can write from Gandhian principles of trusteeship and stewardship, that it depends on individual where he wants to take the nation and world as such. Then in example you can write about Hitler, that Hitler went against these basic principles. He did not have righteousness in his heart, righteousness in his aims, that defined his character, that brought disharmony to his home country and world at large. And again, on the other view, you can quote Gandhi, that because from the previous quote, it was a quote given by Gandhi, so it should strike that you can use Gandhi in this quote. So you can write, Gandhiji had righteousness in his heart that defined his character, that brought harmony not only in India but also in other nations like Africa and world as a whole. So that brings us to the end of section A. In my book you can find various references. I have uploaded the references of questions and the answer content on my blog, that is mudjainblog.wordpress.com. So you can find detailed pics and all from the book, that which question you can write what. I'll be discussing two case studies now, because discussing case studies is a headache as such, but I'll be discussing two case studies. First is, you are heading the rescue operations in an affected area, in an area affected by several natural calamity. Thousands of people are rendered homeless and deprived of food, drinking water and other basic amenities. Rescue work has been disrupted by heavy rainfall and damage to supply routes. The local people are seething with anger against the delayed, limited rescue operations. When your team reaches the affected area, the people there heckle and even assault some of the team members. One of your team members is even severely injured. Faced with crisis, some team members plead with you to call off the operations, fearing threats to their life. In such trying circumstances, what will be your response? Examine qualities of a public servant which will be required to manage this situation. So this year's case studies are a bit different from what used to come. There used to be a case, then the examiner would want you to write the various scenarios, merits and demerits, and then choose an option. But this year's case studies, I find them linked with theory. So you have to read theory, you need to know the theory and then implement the theory in the case studies. Still, my advice would be, if such case studies come in the next year as well, do not just limit yourself to the bookish theory, involve the actors and the dilemmas given in the case. Because there is a purpose that UPSC has given you such actors and such dilemmas in the case. If you do not involve them, if you write a generic answer, then you won't be doing justice with the case itself. So again, as I have detailed in one of my previous videos at Free Academy and also my own channel, that you need to start with actors involved in the case. Then you need to write dilemmas involved in the case. So first is the actors involved. Now, how do you proceed with this? While you read the case, underline the actors involved, the stakeholders involved in the case, and circle the dilemmas involved in the case. Focus, because you hardly get time to relook at the case. You get at least maybe 14 minutes max to solve one case study, and coming to the last two case studies, you hardly have 10 minutes in all. So you need to write two case studies in 10 minutes or 14 minutes. So that is a very short time to write, to read again and again. So focus while you read and mark as you read. So in this question, when I was reading yesterday, I marked rescue operation, natural calamity, thousands of people, homeless, food, water, basic amenities, heavy rainfall disruption, supply routes, local people, anger, delayed limited rescue, team has reached, people heckle and assault, team member injured, some team members plead, threat to life. So these are the keywords of this case study. These would make actors and dilemmas, like actors are me, my team, the injured team member, the members who are pleading to call off the rescue operations, the locals who are angered, and the homeless. Dilemmas involved are rescue, your team, and the angered locals. Now, what will be your response? Do not say that you will run away. That will end the question then and there, and you will definitely lose all 20 marks. So first comes what is the priority right now, that one of your team member is injured. I know there is a rescue operation. You might want to take ethical view that you will look after only and only the rescue operations, but this is not how it goes in services, because you are the leader of your team. You have to help your team first, because if your team goes down, you will be alone in that situation, and trust me, you won't be able to handle it. So first aid for the injured team member is the most important thing that you have to do. Then calm down the team, because the members who are demanding to call off the operations, you have to calm them down, because as I said, it will be tough to handle with less team members or alone. So in this, you can invoke ethical principles of emotional intelligence to tell the team members the gravity of the situation. Like similarly, you will calm down the locals who are angry. You will tell them that, see, there is a natural calamity, the routes are disrupted, the rainfall is heavy. It is not that rescue itself is not taking place. We have reached, it is delayed, but then we are trying our best to help you guys. Then invoke emotional intelligence in this. Try to change their attitude towards you in that grave situation. Then comes points, like cliche points that you will see in all rehabilitation processes, that you will provide them with food, water, and it is written that they are homeless, so you will try to arrange for makeshift tents as soon as possible. This will completely calm down the situation. This will help you in rescue and rehab. Qualities. Now coming to the second part. Second part was, examine the qualities of a public servant which will be required to manage the situation. Emotional intelligence, I have already told you. So next, just pick and choose from syllabus all the qualities you can implement here, like attitude. Like if you have positive attitude, if you can lead your team from the front, you will be able to handle the situation. Collegiality, you can find, you can Google the definition. It means team building and teamwork, working as a team. So this particular case study, you can mention about collegiality. Then is duty. So it is your duty to lead the rescue operations, to carry out rescue operations, and hence it in this question you can write about duty. You can quote Kant or quote Gandhi. Just give a passing reference. So this giving of passing reference content. Selflessness from Mulan committee is important principle that you will depict if you carry out rescue operations despite threat to your own life in such situations. Fortitude, the cardinal virtue given by Aristotle and Thomas Aquinas, that is courage during adversity, is clearly depicted in this case study. prudence. Prudence is making the right decision at right time. So this is a principle that you can for yourself see in the solution that I give. Then draw a diagram. Diagram is must in case study for part for section A. If you are not able to draw a diagram in say 5 out of 13 questions, then it is completely fine. But in case study that is of 20 marks, I need one diagram at least. I used to draw one or two diagrams in every case study. So that also helps in filling up space and breaking the monotony. And not many aspirants, despite knowing that they have to draw a diagram, still they do not draw diagrams in case study. So gain whatever advantage you can by drawing diagrams. Lastly, conclude. Conclusion is the most important part of case study. This is an area where even if you have missed the crux of the case, you try to digress the examiner to the point that you have handled the case well. So how do you do that? Just write a line. So the given solution is holistic solution that addresses various actors and various dilemmas mentioned in the case. So you can mention actors in the bracket and dilemmas in bracket. So this will literally force the examiner that yes, this guy might have addressed various actors and dilemmas in the case, and he might give you 5 if he was giving you 4 out of 10 or 10 out of 20. Next question is, honesty and uprightness are the hallmarks of a civil servant. So in this case study, I'll tell you the keywords as I read. So I marked honesty and uprightness. Civil servants possessing these qualities are considered as the backbone of any strong organization. In line of duty, this is a keyword, in line of duty, they take various decisions. Various decisions is a keyword. At times, some become bona fide mistakes. Bona fide mistake is a keyword. As long as such decisions are not taken intentionally and do not become benefit personally. Intentionally and personal benefit are keywords. The officer cannot be said to be guilty, though such decisions may at times lead to unforeseen adverse consequences in long term. Unforeseen adverse consequence is keyword. In the recent past, a few mistakes have surfaced wherein civil servants have been implicated for bona fide mistakes. Civil servants implicated for bona fide mistake is a keyword. They have often been prosecuted and even imprisoned. Imprisoned is a keyword. The instances have greatly rattled the moral fiber of the civil servants. Moral fiber is a keyword. How does functioning of civil services? What measures can be taken to ensure the honest civil servants are not implicated for the bona fide mistakes on their part? Justify your answer. Very general question. If you remove the case itself, and I have given you 2 lines that there is seen a trend where bona fide mistakes committed by civil servants are leading to prosecution. What is the effect and what is the solution? You can easily answer. Then what is the use of the case? As I told in the previous question, you have to identify actors and dilemmas and use them in the case. Despite the fact that the case studies are different this year, you have to follow the same mechanism that you used to follow earlier. Same approach of dividing the case into actors, then dilemmas, and using the actors and dilemmas in your answers. So the actors in this question can be upright officers, other officers, judiciary, media, and government. Dilemmas in the case that are mentioned are, see, so you can easily write about 3 points: bona fide mistakes, decisions not taken intentionally, not benefit personally, and unforeseen adverse consequences. So that shows that there is no criminal intention. Then second dilemma is honest mistakes versus dishonest crimes. This was a term. Dilemma between efficiency and accountability has been asked by UPSC in one or other exam. You can easily quote this dilemma in this question. And last dilemma is, as written in the case itself, rattled the moral fiber. So the moral fiber and morale of the public officers is at threat. So that is a dilemma. Now coming to the case questions, how is the functioning affected? So as written in the case, without mens rea, some civil servants have been jailed. So you can write this line that this affects the functioning of civil services. Then decision making has become tough. Even the honest officers tend to think twice because they do not know the unforeseen results, byproducts that their decision might have in future. Then take the other view also. It becomes easier to implicate honest officers in wake of such instances as long consequence of decision are unknown, while those who are dishonest take the veil of such threats and do not perform the duty itself. So there are officers who might not take decisions, who are known that this, if the file has gone to this particular officer, he won't sign it, he won't take a decision, he lacks a spine. So in the current situation, such officers can also take the veil of the threat by the three C's, that is the CBI, CVC, etc., and do not take decision. So they can hide their mistakes or criminal intentions or intentions of omission. Next comes, what are the measures? And you have to justify the answers. So first is, as in the case, mens rea. Mens rea, as I told, it is the case is not having criminal intention, there is no mens rea, because the mistakes are bona fide, personal benefit is not there, mistakes are not intentional, and adverse consequences were unforeseen. So there needs to be change with respect to mens rea in the Prevention of Corruption Act. You can easily pick these 4 points and write in the points in your answer here. Then I mentioned judiciary as one of the actor, because it is judiciary that is implicating and prosecuting such officers. So you can write, honorable courts need to take 360 degree view of the issues and take mens rea into account. Then I made media as an actor in this case. So write a measure related to media trials. Media trials of late have created too much of sensationalism. So much so that even you can say that judiciary is impacted somehow by the media trials. So say no to media trials, say no to sensationalist journalism. Then there needs to be checks between honest versus dishonest mistakes. There is something called recording of reasons. So at officer level, while you take decision, you need to record your reasons. So this should become a standard operating procedures where an officer must record the reasons for taking a decision. This thing would help him or her few years down the line when unforeseen consequences occurred. Then from ethics point of view, you can include doctrine of karma as given in Gita, that do not fear, do not worry about the results, just do your duty. You can invoke deontology that Kant said. Then you can also write that you can write about teleological theories in a opposite view, that it is not always good to follow teleological approach. It is not always good to see the end result because you have to take decision. Some or other person has to take decision. The end result might be negative in long run, but then you have to take decision. Also, standard operating procedure, you can write that keep your seniors in confidence. And while implicating and prosecuting such a public servant, the 360 degree view must be taken. His service record must be checked properly. you can take feedback from the people served by him, etc. Draw a diagram and conclude as I told in the previous case study. So this is all from my side. Now I'll take a couple of questions. So maybe somebody has joined late and I have been asked question. Maybe there is some problem, I'm not able to see the question. So I'd like to end the session here. If you have any doubts, any queries, you can reach out to me on my blog or on my channel or through FreeCadmy. My blog is mudijainblog.wordpress.com and I am available on YouTube by my own name. You can Google and you will easily find, or you can join me at my Telegram group. And lastly, I would like to say that you can go for any book, but then I am sure that my book is good enough to be used to solve this year papers. I have given detailed differences on my blog and I am sure it would be very helpful. Thank you.